beautiful song and wonderful words to it. And I know that you enjoy singing that. Thank you for your good singing this evening. Thank you for the good time of worship. It's just good to be in the house of the Lord. And it's good to sing His praises, good to fellowship together, and it's good to study the Word of God. And so we want to look to our Bible now in Isaiah chapter number 22. Isaiah chapter number 22, we'll read for our text from verse 1 down through verse number 7. And here we're looking at the prophecy against Jerusalem here in Isaiah chapter number 22. And so let's read the text and then we'll pray and see what the Lord has for our teaching and our understanding this evening. Isaiah 22, beginning with verse 1, the burden of the valley of vision. What aileth thee now, that thou art wholly gone up to the housetops? Thou that art full of stirs, a tumultuous city, a joyous city. Thy slain men are not slain with sword, nor dead in battle. All thy rulers are fled together. They are bound by the archers. All that are found in thee are bound together, which have fled from far. Therefore said I, look away from me, I will weep bitterly. Labor not to comfort me because of the spoiling of the daughter of my people. For it is a day of trouble and of treading down and of perplexity by the Lord God of hosts in the valley of vision, breaking down the walls and of crying to the mountains. And Elam bare the quiver with chariots of men and horsemen, and Kir uncovered the shield. And it shall come to pass that thy choicest valleys shall be full of chariots, and the horsemen shall set themselves in array at the gate. Now let's pray together. Lord, thank you for the reading of the Word of God this evening, for the opportunity that you've given us now to study your Word together. Lord, we thank you for our study through the book of the prophet Isaiah. And Lord, we pray that you'd help us to understand your Word by the preaching of your Word in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Lord, that we can learn more of you, that we can be better equipped to serve you. And Lord, for that, we'll thank you and praise you together. In Jesus' name we humbly pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. In this this burden, this prophecy of Isaiah, we're talking about a prophecy against Jerusalem. For after pronouncing prophecies against the various nations and enemies of Israel, Isaiah turns his attention to Judah and Jerusalem. Jerusalem would be first besieged by the Assyrians and then later devastated by the Babylonians. And the background of this you can find and study over in 2 Kings chapter 18 and chapter 19. We understand thereabouts, give or take a few years and all, of course, but we understand that this prophecy of Isaiah was written probably around the year 740 B.C. The Assyrian siege of Jerusalem took place in 701 B.C. when Hezekiah was king of Judah. The Babylonian invasion happened in two times. In fact, there were two sieges by the Assyrians as well. But Babylonian invasion involved the year 597 BC when Jeconiah was king of Judah, and then in 587 BC when Zedekiah was the king of Judah. And that's when Judah was utterly destroyed and the temple destroyed and all the things of the temple carried away to Nebuchadnezzar's palace there in Babylon. And so Isaiah really is speaking of both of these events. It's applied especially to the soonest one would be the siege of Jerusalem by Sennacherib, king of Assyria. And then the furthest one would be the invasion by the Babylonians. And so he describes some things here that we can, I believe, learn from. First of all, you'll notice in verse 1 down through verse number 3, what we could call the sad state of the city. Sad state of the city. Verse 1, the burden of the valley of vision. What aileth thee now, that thou art wholly gone up to the housetops? Let me mention to you that phrase there, the valley of vision, it would refer to Jerusalem. There's indications of that in the Bible, the Word of God. In fact, if you drop down to verse number 9 in this same chapter here, chapter 22, where he says, "Ye have seen also the breaches of the city of David, that they are many, and ye gathered together the waters of the lower pool." All of that in the verses following is describing the city of Jerusalem. And so the valley of vision, God oftentimes would reveal himself to Jerusalem in visions. Jerusalem would be a city of the prophets. Isaiah was there. Other prophets was there. Jeremiah was there and the others. And so it was a city that all throughout the history of the nation of Israel, the nation of Judah, that very much prophecy was brought towards that city of Jerusalem. And Jerusalem surely knew the inhabitants of Jerusalem. They knew of the prophets, and they knew of the preaching of the prophets. There would be just about every king in Jerusalem, in Judah, from David and all the way through. There'd be a prophet that would be involved in that time of that particular king's leadership in the city. So prophecy was not something new or unusual to the people of Jerusalem. But here we see a very sad state of events concerning the city and concerning the people of the city. There in verse number 1, when Isaiah gives this question to them, he says, "What aileth thee now? Thou art wholly gone up to the housetops." I look at that in that first part of that statement where he says, "What aileth thee now?" To me, in our vernacular today, we'd say something like, "What's the matter with you? What are you doing?" That's like what Isaiah is saying here. Where I grew up in Northwest Huntsville, it'd be more like, "What's the matter with you?" But what's wrong with you? What you're all just going up to the housetops. It's an interesting note that we have here that Isaiah is pointing out. Isaiah really, if we'll understand it, I think Isaiah is preaching to the people and reproaching them, condemning them, if you will, and questioning them. But he's reproaching them for partying when they ought to have been repenting. That's the idea of going up on the housetops. They are wholly gone up to the housetops. It was a custom of the people in that day, you see, to go up there in and around Jerusalem. The roofs of their houses would be flat. They would have the kind of a raised border around it of their stone and block to protect them, you know, from falling, slipping and falling off the roof and that sort of thing. And so it'd be a place where they would gather, perhaps especially in the times of the evening, maybe after having supper, or maybe they even have tables and things up there, and they go up there to eat at times and so forth. And so the people use their housetops for that. It was their custom to rest on the house, on the roof of the housetops. Recreation would take place there. There'd be gatherings there. They'd have people over, and maybe there's not enough room inside. They'd get up on the housetop. That's where they would have their parties. That's where their gatherings would go on. That's where their recreation and so forth and relaxation would take place. And so the picture is here when Isaiah basically is saying to them, what in the world is wrong with you? What, you're all just getting on the housetops. You're all just carrying on and so forth. You see, Isaiah had been prophesying to them. Isaiah had been warning them. And the approach of the Assyrian army was almost at this time, we can understand. It's like you could hear the hoofbeats of the horses if you listen closely enough. The Assyrian army was on its way. And Isaiah is saying to them, but you're up here and you're partying when you ought to be repenting. They were overlooking the seriousness of the situation. They'd become idle. And he says, "Thou art wholly gone up to the housetops," it sounds like he's saying to them that looks like that's what they spend the most of their time doing. Most of their time is just spent on the housetops. Most of their time is for partying around, just partying and playing around. They're not serious about anything. It's a picture of a society that has fixed itself on worldly pleasures. Kind of reminds me of our time we're living in right now. As Paul would write to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, "This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers, here it is, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. That's kind of the picture that Isaiah is painting for us here of that situation in Jerusalem in this day. The invasion is coming. The siege is coming. The enemy is on its way. And yet they're just on the housetops. They're on the rooftops. And they're playing their games. And there's no serious looking out at all. It's a sad state. He continues to describe this thing, and that's I think it's good to understand it this way because the following verses really describe this, the whole thing, where he says in verse number 2, "Thou art full of stirs, a tumultuous city, a joyous city. The slain men are not slain with the sword, nor dead in battle." They're not going out to meet the enemy. Isaiah's prophesied, they've heard the enemy's coming, but instead of going out to meet them out in the field, out away from the city to protect the inhabitants of the city and so forth, which really is what they should have been doing, but instead they just laid around at home. It's a place that is full of stirs, he describes it there. That phrase there, I understand, means crashing or loud clamor. There's a lot of noise going on. I just picture it. You picture it in what we see around us in our day to day. And you're talking about having a big party. You're talking about the loud music, the carrying on, the shouting and the carrying on, the laughing and the playing around and all of these things you can picture in your mind. And then also he even says a tumultuous city, a joyous city. It's what they're giving over to. It's a city that is wholly given to pleasure instead of looking out for the safety of the people and instead of serving God. You know, we can apply this today. We really can. Because the lifestyle, let's be honest with ourselves, the lifestyle of most people, let's just use America for the example, but I'd say it applies to the whole world today. But the lifestyle of most people nowadays that we're living in right now is based on the pleasure of the flesh. Let's have a good time. If it feels good, do it. And that's the pleasures of the flesh. I mean, you look at, you take television for an example. Even if you're just watching the news or something, those commercials come on. And by and large, what you find is the majority of things that are being promoted, things that are trying to be sold, Well, it's the beer is involved in it, the liquor's involved in it, the parties are involved in it, all the music and everything that's going on, the worldliness and all that's going on, that's all you're seeing out there. And it's as if sometimes my wife and I talk about every now and then that it's just like that on the television. That's the way they think that everybody is. They think everybody ought to be having a party. Everybody ought to be drinking the beer. Everybody ought to be doing the rap and the rock and all the other stuff that they do with their music and their carrying on. We have the example here in our home area of Cullman, Alabama, where just a few weeks ago that Rock the South was here. And what do they tell us? Maybe close to 100,000 people or something like that. That would come down to this basically a rural type of county that we have here in Cullman County. Cullman's not a big city. It's a good sized town, but it's certainly not what you'd call a big city. Even here in Alabama, it's not Huntsville, it's not Birmingham, it's not Mobile, it's not Montgomery, it's not these places like that. I mean, it's Cullman of all places. And they descend upon this town and they have all the goings on and you see that on the news. Isaiah is really kind of describing a time and a city that is like this. And it's a sad state that's going on here. But it's the way it is with most people in our world today. And if we think about it, well, yeah, that's the world out there, boy, it's a mess. Now, let's hold on. Much of what's called church worship today, let's be honest with ourselves, it also is based on an appeal to the flesh. I looked up the website and watched part of a video. I didn't stay with it to listen to any of the preaching or anything else on it. But I won't say the name, but it's a church in Cullman calls itself a church. But it's a church in Cullman that you hear a lot of people say that they've gone to this place. They don't use the term Baptist. They've gone to this church and say that, you know, they like it and everything. I looked it up. And my friend, listen, you talk about everything. It's just like my early teenage years before getting saved and going to a rock and roll concert at the Civic Center in Huntsville, Alabama. I mean, on their platform in this church, there's the fog machines, there's these lights and everything, and even people gathered up against the platform. They don't have an altar. It's like a platform, like a stage at a rock concert. And they're up against there doing their dancing and they're carrying on and everything. And this is a so-called church right here in Cullman, Alabama. It's based on an appeal to the flesh. And that's what's going on in America today. In Colossians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul writes in verse number 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom and teaching and admonishing one another. Listen, in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19, the Apostle Paul writes, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Folks, that's not what is going on in modern churches today. It's an appeal to the flesh. Everything is about the flesh. Everything is about just not much different at all from what you see the videos of Rock the South when it's here in the summertime and other places like that. You're seeing it in churches. You're seeing it in places where they call themselves Baptist churches. So Isaiah is describing, really, do you see it here, the sad state of the city of Jerusalem? He's describing a sad time. He said there in verse 2 also, thy slain men are not slain with a sword, nor dead in battle. And as we said, they're not going out to face the enemy. They're not going out to try to protect the city. No, they're just staying inside the walls. Death is going to come to many of them, but it'll come through starvation or disease as the city will be under siege. And then in verse 3, all thy rulers are fled together. They are bound by the archers. All that are found in thee are bound together, which have fled from far. That verse really says to me that Isaiah is making the point that you've all given up without a fight. You ain't even trying. You've given up without a fight. It says all thy rulers are fled together. That it's not necessarily meaning just the king, you know, the one ruler, but others that are in places of authority, others that had the responsibility for the protection of the city, for the welfare of the people. People who have been put in place of government and officials and such things as that. Well, they're getting out of there. They have fled. They all turn together and flee. And so all of these are in authority. And it was like that they're trapped. They're trying to escape. But rather than defend the city the way they ought to, they chose to flee, to save their own necks. And in doing so, they were captured and put to death as well. The Bible describes in particular when the Babylonian invasion came in 2 Kings chapter 25. 2 Kings chapter 25, I'll read some of it to you. 2 Kings 25, beginning with verse 1. It came to pass in the ninth year of his reign, in the tenth month, on the tenth day of the month, that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came, he and all his host, against Jerusalem, and pitched against it. And they built forts against it round about, and the city was besieged unto the 11th year of King Zedekiah. And on the ninth day of the fourth month, the famine prevailed in the city, and there was no bread for the people of the land, and the city was broken up, and all the men of war fled by night, by the way of the gate between two walls, which is by the king's garden. Now the Chaldees were against the city round about, and the king went the way toward the plain, and the army of the Chaldees pursued after the king and overtook him in the plains of Jericho, and all his army was scattered from him. So they took the king and brought him up to the king of Babylon, to Riblah, and they gave judgment upon him. And they slew the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes, and put out the eyes of Zedekiah, bound him with fetters and brass, and carried him to Babylon. That's what would happen. Isaiah is telling them, really prophesying of this, and telling ahead of time what's going to come, the fate that is going to come on that city of Jerusalem. It's a sad state for the city there, isn't it? And then notice something else that Isaiah shows us in all of this. I see the sad state of the city, but then I see also in verse number 4 and verse number 5, the sorrow of the prophet. The sorrow of the prophet Isaiah. Verse number 4, therefore said I, look away from me, I will weep bitterly. Labor not to comfort me because of the spoiling of the daughter of my people. Isaiah was one that saw the reality of what was happening. Not only that the enemy was approaching and the people were not doing anything about it, but he saw the reality, I think, of the spiritual issues and how that the terrible outcome of Judah would be so great that Isaiah is just overwhelmed in telling it. And so he says, I will weep bitterly. This is greatness of sorrow. And you see also the strength of his passion. Because he says, I will weep bitterly. Labor not to comfort me. Don't try to cheer me up. He says, because the spoiling of the daughter of my people. He's talking about his countrymen. Talking about his people, which were as dear to him as a daughter would be. That's the way he's describing it here. And so you see the sorrow of the prophet in verse number 5. For it is a day of trouble, he says. A day of trouble and of treading down and of perplexity by the Lord God of hosts in the valley of vision, breaking down the walls and of crying to the mountains. Isaiah prophesies here of a time of trouble, perplexity, distress, and confusion, the breaking down of the walls. I think specifically we're talking about the physical breaking down the walls, which happened with the Babylonian invasion, the later one, the walls being torn down around old Jerusalem. But also, this was not, the thing about it is, I think there's a spiritual point to it as well. And all this was not merely from men, nor by chance, but it came about by the permission and the appointment of God. And it was to humble his people for their sins. And so they cry out to the mountains. It says that crying to the mountains, breaking down the walls, crying to the mountains. They're looking for help, looking for shelter, looking for protection. Isaiah describes it as a people that are crying so loud that their cry perhaps reaches the distant mountains in the distance and maybe made their cry to echo off the mountains back into the city. That's the kind of distressful time that there is here. There's a breaking down of the walls, I think not only physically, but spiritually as well. Because I think that's a part of their guilt. It's part of the reason why God is bringing this against them because of their disobedience and because of the spiritual issue, the spiritual problem. If they had just turned to God before, years before, if they'd recognized where they had disobeyed God, and you recall what we talked about in that the word of God, that how they were to let the land lay fallow at once every 7 years. They were not to till the land and everything, but they just kept doing it anyway. That's the reason that the Babylonian captivity would come, and we've already studied about that. And so there's a spiritual problem here as well, but Isaiah is describing a very sad state of the city, and he illustrates it by the deepness of his own sorrow at what he has to prophesy of, what he has to warn the people about, what is coming. But in verse 6 and verse number 7, you see something else. You see also, I think, the situation on the outside of the city. some things are going on. The situation outside, verse 6 and verse 7, and Elam bare the quiver with chariots of men and horsemen, and Kir uncovered the shield. And verse 7, it shall come to pass that thy choicest valley shall be full of chariots, and the horsemen shall set themselves in array at the gate. This is what's going on outside the city now. Verse 6, it mentions these two people, these two nations, if you will, of Elam and Kir. These were allies in the Assyrian army. They had joined together with Sennacherib, with the king of Assyria, to come against Judah and against Jerusalem that besieged the city of Jerusalem. And the fact that they carried the quiver, it describes there in verse number 6, it means they were ready to fight. They were ready to fight. Now this wasn't, think about it, this wasn't the Assyrians. These were allies to the Assyrians. But man, they were right out there and they were ready. They brought their quivers with them. They brought their ammunition with them. They brought their bows. They brought their quivers. They brought their arrows. They brought whatever else that they had. But they brought it with them. They were ready for the battle. They were ready to battle alongside Assyria and come against the city of Jerusalem. And so they're ready to fight. And then they were equipped for far away places, because it talks about having the chariots of men and the horsemen. They're ready to travel. They're ready to run with Assyria and Sennacherib, the king of Assyria. They're ready to work with them. Kerr has uncovered the shield and so forth. He's got his weapons ready, as described there in verse number 6. Equipped for those faraway places with the chariots, the horses, and so forth. Verse number 7, it says, it shall come to pass that the choicest valleys shall be full of chariots and horsemen, and the horsemen shall set themselves in array at the gate. Valleys lying both in and around Jerusalem. And we know that that's true geographically for that city of Jerusalem. And these valleys would be full of enemy troops. It just shows a readiness to fight. It shows Assyria is coming. Assyria's even got their allies, the other two nations involved in it as well. They've got their weapons. They've got their chariots. They've got their horses. They've set themselves up right outside the gate. I mean, they're right there. They're right there on the scene. They're right there ready to fight. They're ready for the battle. They're all equipped. There's nothing that is lacking. There's nothing that's been left behind. And all of this shows their readiness for the battle. But Jerusalem was not ready. Jerusalem was not ready. This type of a setup, it's interesting, but it was the same case for both the Assyrian siege of Jerusalem and then later both Babylonian invasions of Judah and Jerusalem as well. Jerusalem was never ready. They could have been ready. They had the prophets. They had Isaiah. They had Jeremiah. They've had others all through the century. Isn't it amazing? All through the life and the history of the Old Testament people of God in Israel and Judah, God, I don't think there's really was ever a time other than when we come to the end of the Old Testament, when we come to after Malachi, and you've got 400 years where there was no word of God until the coming of John the Baptist and the beginning of the New Testament. But other than that, it really seems like God always had his prophets. He always had his men. He always brought his word. Every king, as I said, there'd be a prophet along the way. There'd be Isaiah, as we see here. There'd be Jeremiah. There would be Ezekiel. There'd be Elijah. There'd be Elisha. There's Samuel, who is both a prophet and a priest as well. And so there was Nathan the prophet in David's time also. And so there always was. Even back in the days of the kings and the days of old wicked king Ahab and Jezebel, there as well, there is Elijah, and then later there is Elisha. And then you remember how we read in the Bible, there was what was called the sons of the prophets. I mean, there are all kinds of them. And so God never left Jerusalem. And he never left Israel, he never left Judah without a warning, without plenty of warning, without plenty of word. But the amazing thing is, you know, they could have been easily ready for anything, but they were not ready. The Assyrian siege came also in two separate invasions. The first time, Hezekiah thought he could buy his way out of it. Over in 2 Kings chapter number 18, you can read about this. Let me find that for you. 2 Kings 18 and verse 13, reading down through verse 16. 2 Kings 18, now in the 14th year of King Hezekiah did Sennacherib, king of Assyria, come up against all the fenced cities of Judah and took them. Hezekiah, king of Judah, sent to the king of Assyria to Lachish, saying, I have offended, return from me, that which thou puttest on me will I bear. And the king of Assyria appointed unto Hezekiah, king of Judah, 300 talents of silver and 30 talents of gold. And Hezekiah gave him all the silver that was found in the house of the Lord and in the treasures of the king's house. At that time did Hezekiah cut off the gold from the doors of the temple of the Lord or from the pillars which Hezekiah, king of Judah, had overlaid and gave it to the king of Assyria. At that first time around, Hezekiah tried to buy his way out of it. But then there would be a second siege against Jerusalem as well. And in that second time, Hezekiah prayed. Hezekiah did what he should have done the first time. But that second time, Hezekiah prayed, and God answered in chapter 19 of 2 Kings. 2 Kings chapter 19. Let me read for you a few verses there. Verse number 14. Verse 14. And Hezekiah received the letter of the hand of the messengers and read it. Now this was when Rabshakeh, that captain of Sennacherib's army, was there with troops around the outside of Jerusalem. All the people were shut in the walls. They were trapped in there as they had that siege against them. And he was reading out all this stuff and saying all these things and really trying to disturb the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And you can read all of that in 2 Kings 19. And so the message is given. The man's told them, says, you need to give up. You need to surrender. In verse 14, 2 Kings 19, Hezekiah received the letter of the hand of the messengers. It was a letter from that Rabshakeh and read it. Hezekiah went up into the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. Hezekiah prayed before the Lord and said, O Lord God of Israel, which dwellest between the cherubims, thou art the God, even thou alone of all the kingdoms of the earth. Thou hast made heaven and earth. Lord, bow down thine ear and hear. Open, Lord, thine eyes and see and hear the words of Sennacherib, which hath sent him to the words of Sennacherib, which hath sent him to reproach the living God. Of a truth, Lord, the kings of Assyria have destroyed the nations and their lands. And he goes on and describes more of that down in verse number 20. Then Isaiah the prophet of Amoz sent to Hezekiah, saying, Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, that which thou hast prayed to me against Sennacherib, king of Assyria, I have heard. Amen. It's what he should have done in the first place. Amen. He just laid it before the Lord. He got that letter. He said, this is, and that letter from the king of Assyria, from his captain of his army and so forth, said, you better give up. You better surrender because we're going to get you. Basically, to sum it up. And Hezekiah goes and he lays it before the Lord. He says, Lord, here it is. Here's what they're saying. Here's what they're threatening. Here's what they say that they're going to do. And he lays it out before him. And God heard his prayer and God answered his prayer. If you happen to be looking there in 2 Kings chapter 19, look at verse 32. Verse 32. Therefore, thus said the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city, nor shoot an arrow there, nor come before it with shield, nor cast a bank against it. By the way that he came, by the same shall he return, and shall not come into this city, saith the Lord. For I will defend this city to save it for mine own sake and for my servant David's sake. And it came to pass that night that the angel of the Lord went out and smote in the camp of the Assyrians 185,000. And when they arose early in the morning, behold, they were all dead corpses. So Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed and went and returned and dwelt in Nineveh. They did, the people of Jerusalem did not even have to fight. God did it for them, as Hezekiah would bring it before the Lord. And so you see, for us, the spiritual situation outside, the spiritual situation outside, I'm talking about outside of the church, I'm talking about out in the world, in the society, in the culture around us, in our country. The spiritual situation outside is really somewhat the same as that siege on Jerusalem. Because you see, we too are surrounded by the enemy. We're surrounded by the enemy, and we must be ready. As Peter tells us in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, church, your adversary as a roaring lion walketh about seeking whom he may devour. And I don't have to tell you who that adversary is, amen. He's the enemy of God. He's the enemy of God's people. He's the enemy of God's church. He's the enemy of Israel. He is the devil. He is Satan himself. He is our enemy. He's that roaring lion. And he's out there. And his demons are out there. That's the spiritual situation outside. You know, what do we need to do? Well, I just think we should do like Hezekiah did. We need to lay it all before the Lord. We need to lay it all before the Lord. We need to know that we are in a war and put on the armor of God. In Ephesians chapter number six, you know the text, Ephesians chapter 6. He tells us about that armor of God. Ephesians chapter 6, picking up verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Hey, listen, that's what's on the outside. That's the situation outside. It is a war. It is a battle. We have a great enemy, but God's given us a great armor. Amen. He's given us the armor of God, that we can stand against the wiles of the devil, that we can wrestle against against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. We can take on that whole armor of God, and we can stand, and we can lay it out before the Lord. And so understand this, we've got a situation outside today as well. We need to do like Hezekiah, lay it before the Lord. And we need to put on the armor of God. And may I say to you this evening, church, there is no need to fear. There is no need to compromise, because in Jesus, I believe we already have the victory. Can you say amen to that? I believe we already have the victory. John chapter 16, verse 33, Jesus said to his disciples, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. 1 John chapter 5, verse 4, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. Listen, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Amen. We're in a very similar situation like the city of Jerusalem was in this day, in Isaiah's day. And we see a sad state of affairs. Just as Jerusalem, Isaiah describes them as giving themselves over to pleasure. When they should have been repenting and turning to God, they're on top of their roofs having a party and carrying on in the lust of the flesh and in the pleasures of the flesh. It's what's going on in around our world today. And then with the sorrow of the prophet, that needs to be us, doesn't it? We need to have that kind of sorrow. We need to understand the seriousness of the situation. And we need to see the situation that is on the outside. There's a battle out there. There's a war out there. But we need not fear. We're on the winning side. Amen. Jesus has already provided for the victory for all of his children. Amen. He's already provided the victory. And so, you know, the thing about it is, What we need to be doing is not huddled up behind the walls like the people in Jerusalem on that day. We ought to just stand with confidence and faith, knowing that we're on the winning side, knowing that we have the victory. And we ought to just lift up our heads and look up, for our redemption draweth nigh. We know that. We know that this world is not our home. And we know, as we said, we know that we already have the victory, no matter how tough a situation it might become, and it may become very tough in the world around us. And we know that. We're not ignorant of it. We understand it. We know this, that evil is going to wax worse and worse in this world. We understand that. We know all this nonsense is going to continue to go on, because, as we've said before, it really looks like America is a Romans chapter 1 nation today, a nation that God has given over to reprobate mind. All this nonsense, this homosexuals and transgender and all this stuff that's going on, and this far left politics and all this stuff that's going on in our society today. We know we're living in these last days, the very last days. We know that Jesus is coming soon, but we're on the victory side. I think what we ought to do is just always lay it all out before the Lord, believe in Him, trust in Him, and we ought to walk like we're the victors. We ought to live like we know we've, listen, not like we're winning, but that we've already won, and we have already won by what Christ did for us on Calvary's cross. Amen? Amen. We're soldiers of the cross, and we have the victories already assured. And the victory is already ours. It's just up to us to live like it and look like it and act like it. Amen. Let's stand together, our heads bowed and our eyes closed, for prayer. Lord, thank you for the Word of God. Thank you for this time you've given us to come together and to study. Lord, we pray for someone that may catch this message online. Maybe there's someone that will catch this message and will realize that they don't have the victory. They don't have the victory that we have in our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. They need to be saved. They need to be bought by the blood. They need to be born again. Lord, we pray that you would speak to people's hearts, that you would stir their thoughts to look at their own selves, to look at their own needs, to realize what's happening in this situation around this world around us, and Lord, that they would turn to you, Lord Jesus, and trust you to be their own Savior before it's too late. And Lord, we'll thank you and praise you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. And amen. Let's sing together once again as Brother Tim leads us.
Hey, 331.